best place to start is to talk about the novel. Jay Cox gave you a copy of the novel.
Well, Jay and I have been, you know, friends for many, many years. I'm 68, really, and have a relationship based on exploring, discovering, arguing about different kinds of films,
yeah,
styles, genres. During that period, from 68, about 70, during the 70s, and trying to work together also, mm-hmm, we found that we both had a real love of certain genres. And I guess one would call this kind of thing, I don't want to call it this, but I guess we'll, you know, commit the same sin, but a costume drama.
Mm-hmm.
It had to do more, rather than with costumes, had to do with the culture,
mm-hmm,
and the climate of the times,
mm-hmm,
and how that affects human behavior. We're the same species as we were then.
Mm-hmm.
Just the signals and the rituals around us that are different.
Yeah.
Then how do we behave within that? How are we expected to behave? What,
yeah,
choices do we make? Selfish, not selfish? What constitutes a marriage? What constitutes love? What constitutes both together, possibly? Understanding different historical and cultural approaches to those aspects of life, you know, whether it's birth, marriage, death, all of that, from different ways of thinking, pre-Judeo-Christian, Eastern, all of that. I'm curious.
Mm-hmm.
I was just curious about what keeps us, what makes us the same.
Mm.
I found there was a lot of power in the films that I saw based in those periods, more in the 19th century and the 18th.
Mm-hmm.
You had films of Albert Lewin. I saw Moon and Sixpence.
And the Flying Dutchman.
Well, Moon and Sixpence.
Yes.
And, The Private Affairs of Bellamy. And,
yes,
of course, the Portrait of Dorian Gray. A couple of films by O. Fools. Well, particularly one I saw repeatedly, was on television, was Letter from an Unknown Woman.
Yes.
Somehow, the elegance of it, what I mean by that is the look of it,
mm-hmm,
the camera moves. Not that I was looking at the camera moves, but when I repeatedly found myself viewing the film, whenever,
mm-hmm,
it was shown on TV,
mm-hmm,
I would begin to get a sense of why I was feeling this way about these people.
Yeah.
Renoir,
yeah,
films, American films of Renoir, and The Golden Coach. And then later, catching up with the Visconti films from Italy.
Right.
The Leopard being the key one.
Yeah.
But that has a personal connection because of Sicily. It was even shot in my grandmother's hometown,
mm-hmm,
of Cimina. The operatic nature, opera itself, although I'm not a great fan of opera, we grew up around it. And I got to see Senso, though, when I was in my, say, late teens.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the emotion of it,
mm-hmm,
the operatic nature of the way all of them behave. It's very different from Age of Innocence, but I was attuned to that,
yes,
more.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know anything about class. I just started to identify them with them as people.
Yes.
And so when Jay and I talked about these types of pictures or these stories, and particularly was one that was really important to me, was The Heiress.
The William Wyler movie.
My father had taken me to see it. Very powerful, emotional experience. I think I was about 10 when I saw it. That had to do with the father and the daughter.
Yes.
And the opportunist.
The Montgomery Clift character.
Montgomery Clift, yeah.
Yeah.
The power of her locking the door at the end,
mm,
and climbing up the stairs is transcendent, I thought. I mean, yes, I love Westerns and swashbucklers and anything young boys liked at that time.
Yeah.
But there was something special about the power of the past.
Yeah. You often talk about body language and the way that it expresses emotions. And is that, I get the feeling watching the film again that that's something that you wanted to explore specifically in the way that the clothing of the period.
Well, the clothing dictated how you behave,
yeah,
too. If you wear something straight,
yes,
what I mean is keeping you straight,
right,
it changes your attitude.
Yes.
You walk in a room, you feel more positive.
Yeah.
And so for me, body language through clothing was really important. And then ultimately, I think when Jay gave me the book, he said, if you ever do a film that takes place in the 19th century with a gold costume drawer, he said, this is you.
Mm.
After he gave me the book, I started to read, I stopped. Then I went through some experience where I became very aware of what it is to be trying to communicate in a different way. How should I put it? I'm more open, more volatile, more, you know. But if you come up against or you work with people who are the opposite,
mm-hmm,
I became aware of the power of passivity.
Withholding?
Withholding, the power of not speaking.
Yeah.
The power of not saying what's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You have to think a different way.
Yes.
Then I read the book. and I got it. For me, it's really about the power of, in this story, about what you think you know and what you think you're doing. And in reality, what you are or how other people perceive you. I mean, for example, he actually thinks it's a secret about his relationship with the Countess, or his feelings about the Countess, I should say. Everybody knows. And everybody's protecting their lives, their way of life, you know. So in a sense, there's a quiet conspiracy. Mm-hmm. He thinks he's in a conspiracy. But it's very interesting how it manifests itself in this story by place cards and the social behavior, mm-hmm. of that, the social code at that time. Mm-hmm. And so it's a matter of curiosity and exploring, really. And then taking that behavior and then analyzing it through the visual style, taking genre and trying to explore it in a different way, mm-hmm. and express it a different way. Mm-hmm. You know, there are aspects of Truffaut, aspects of Godard, there's aspects of Albert Lewin, there's aspects of William Wyler, that Visconti, of course, but, you know, Visconti could just walk in a room and it is.
Yes.
It is because it is. He's there. That's who he is. That's who the people are working with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like, you know, me in the street of New York. It's a different thing.
Yeah.
And so it was a matter of exploring and trying to find a kernel of truth.
Yes.
In that, yeah. In a different planet, on a different planet.
And the way that you define that planet with all the inserts of, as you just said, place cards of food, of objects, you know, the cutting of the cigar.
The cigars,
The silver cigarette case and the pen, you know, the new pen.
Yeah, the pen, he had a new pen.
And these, have you seen this? The new stylographic pen.
Mm. The detail
of
a scene, mm-hmm. or the detail of a world, whether it's the right espresso cup in Social Club and Raging Bull.
Right.
Any of this kind of detail I find fascinating. Why he's playing with this? Why, you know, what does that look like? What does that really mean as part of a fetish of that life? Or not fetish, may be the wrong word, but there's something beautiful about the water, the light that's hitting it, and it changes the way you think a little bit as you're speaking. So imagine if that glass was embossed, and it was a turquoise, you know. It has another feeling, because it means something. The color means something. The texture of the fabric means something. And has a lot to do with aesthetic appeal, but also beginnings of what I understood as ritual, which is in the Catholic Church. The ritual of the Mass, and benedictions, and Passion Week, and confirmations, and that sort of thing. It gave a structure, and it meant something. Every move, every move of the hand, legs, whatever, it means something to a group of people.
Yeah. And in this story, every single interaction.
Oh, every interaction.
That.
Yeah, placement. Also, I began to understand the placement of tables. I mean, you could say, well, you come from a working-class family, no wonder. Yeah, true. So a working-class family, though, you still had the father at the head of the table, mm-hmm. the mother at the other side. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There are a few moments in the movie where he realizes, and we realize, how penned in he is. For instance, when he says to the lawyer, Mr. Letterblair, maybe she should get a divorce or something like that, and Letterblair says, oh, do you really? No one has overstepped his bounds
there. He really
has, yeah. He's overstepped his bounds with Mrs. Mingott.
He's thinking dangerously.
Yeah, right.
Thinking himself out of the tribe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's also endangering the tribe.
Yeah.
He doesn't have the right to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in that, from their point of view.
I'd rather see her dead.
Would you really? We should remember marriage is marriage, and Ellen is still a wife. Ellen, see who's here.
That's what led me to explore the picture,
mm-hmm.
and utilize as much as possible that world that they lived in.
Mm-hmm.
But we couldn't even find locations, mm-hmm. that had anything to do with it. We were basically in Troy, New York, for a few weeks. The exteriors there lent itself to that period. But interiors, we had a couple of sets we built. Found some in Park Slope, other places, Philadelphia. Yeah, yeah. The places didn't exist, mm-hmm. from the 1870s.
Mm-hmm.
I discovered that as we were trying to put it together, that it wasn't as readily available.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We basically did the research and found that this family is based on this particular family, and this particular family had these types of pictures in their houses.
Mm-hmm.
Not that they're the same pictures, but the type of bucolic painting. Thomas Cole.
Thomas Cole and the other painters, it's the Hudson River School.
The Hudson River School.
Yeah.
This is what you live with on the wall, a genre painting.
Yeah.
That tells a story, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whether that's high art or low, I don't know. But it's what they were enjoying.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, him receiving books from England,
yeah.
Middlemarch, not reading it, you know? But the obsession with how everything looked and how people behaved for me was kind of interesting, playing out this very passionate story.
Yeah, it's a big part of the emotional architecture of the movie.
Yeah.
People were penned in,
yeah,
in a way.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
The thing about Newland Archer, Daniel Day-Lewis's character, that I thought was very interesting, he's like a boy. He's exploring, thinking that he's doing something daring.
I know he's
when
not.
When Ellen Olenska, you know, she says, I'd love to meet some artists. And he says, oh, I have several painters I can recommend. You know, Julius Beaufort says, do we have any painters in New York? And she says, I meant, you know, actors. And he says, oh. You know, he's just gently chastised. And he feels that he's becoming a man of the world. And then, as you said before, it turns out that he's just completely reined in and slapped down.
And then the question ultimately became, is he to be scorned for that? Particularly because he doesn't have sex with her.
Right.
And that's what pretty much the audience reaction at the time. There was a wonderful filmmaker actor in L.A. And he said, I'm watching the picture. Don't tell me this is a 2.5-hour movie about people who don't make it. Well, they don't make it, but they make something.
They make something. The glove, the taking off of the gloves.
Taking
in the
off
back
the glove,
the carriage.
Yeah. The whole idea of a repression of being very sexy and putting on her shawl at the last dinner party. Mm-hmm. And the camera goes to her shoulder. You know, I guess you could do without the camera move. But then you're talking about taste. I was just trying to break a mold and maybe provoke, there's no doubt. But that type of story doesn't have to look a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
And we took chances. But it has to do with the sweetness of repression, of something never happening, but actually happening.
Right, and it's interesting when she says to him, shall I come to you just once?
Yeah.
It's almost as if a barrier has been broken and there's a little bit of a disappointment.
It's almost a disappointment.
Mm-hmm.
Ultimately, at the end, when he knows that she has played a little game, Winona's character.
Yes, Winona Ryder's character, his wife.
Yeah. He knows he has to stand by the family at that point. It's interesting about responsibility that people are judged and characters are judged by what they could have done.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they didn't. Is there any value to what they did? Well, they were unhappy, but they did it. And they're unhappy the rest of their lives, and they were not able to achieve what they want, but they still lived.
Mm-hmm.
So then is it always the live your dream propaganda.
Right.
People can't always do that. You could try.
Yeah. Unshackle yourself.
Unshackle yourself, but you may not be able to. Then work within the shackles if you can. Something, I don't know. It's not for everyone, I think. And he got as far as he could. She got as far as she could.
Mm-hmm.
She knew what the hell was going on. I mean, between the count and the lawyer and all of that. It's a whole, he never would have, I don't think would have, personally, I don't care if he would have gone to Paris and lived with her. He just couldn't have made it anyway. You know?
Well, that's one of the most beautiful exchanges in the movie when he says, I wish that there were a place that we could go to where none of this mattered. And she said, you know, where is that place?
Where is that place? It doesn't exist.
Yeah.
It just doesn't exist because they've got to deal with themselves, you know, and they're bred a certain way.
Yeah.
Ultimately, he has the children. He has a life with the children. The children have a life with him, with his wife.
She dies at a young age.
She dies at a young age. He apparently is a good father to them.
Mm-hmm.
There's a value there.
Yeah.
That's something he may not have experienced if he had run off and become bohemian.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And expressed his freedom.
Like the moon and sixpence.
The moon and sixpence, yeah. Oh, he was very happy.
Yeah.
I'm being facetious.
Yeah.
No, he was not happy at all. In fact, he says, what's so great about that for me? I love it. He said, burn the paintings.
Mm-hmm.
At the end, it's so sad.
Mm. One of the things about the movie that's very, very important is the sounds of people's voices. And I know that you'd had people to recordings of
Franklin Roosevelt.
Roosevelt and Alice Roosevelt, Teddy Roosevelt's daughter, if I remember correctly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That recording of Whitman reciting America.
Yes, the Ample Street.
Ample. Yeah.
At the end of the 19th century, there is some research material for pronunciation.
Mm-hmm.
They aren't speaking with a British accent, but they're the children of England. It was a country still defining itself.
Yes.
A culture, I should say, finding itself.
Mm-hmm.
It's a culture coming together.
Yeah. And then part of the weave of the movie is Joan Woodward's narration.
Oh, that's...
She really is the
Joan
voice
Woodward
of
is so great. Yeah.
Edith Wharton.
Well, she is, yes. And there was some... It was actually kind of sweet, actually. Some of the studio guys, they were so supporting the film. It was amazing. Mark Canton and all those guys at Columbia. But they did ask, who was speaking? And I never thought of that. Mm-hmm. Somebody's telling me a story. I don't understand.
Yeah.
I said, why is it a woman? I never thought of that. Well, first of all, it's written by a woman. It seemed kind of odd to have a man's voice do it.
No one could ever be jealous of May's triumphs. She managed to give the feeling that she would have been just as serene without them.
I happen to like narration.
Not just for narrative purposes, but
It's really the feel of it, and it's really tone and atmosphere. And in the case of the Edith Wharton, I like the language, I like the use of words. There are some books that you read where you really feel nourished by it, reading a page or a sentence.
Yeah.
And I wanted to have that along with the visual. Mm. But I don't know if we get back into whether a novel could be made into a film. So I don't even want to get into that. But, like, it's something different. Yeah. But why couldn't we have a taste of that? Why couldn't we have a taste of what it sounds like when you read aloud? I don't know. It just seems to me that the words are beautiful.
There are also things cinematically that feel like they grow right out of the novel. And I was thinking, for instance, of the way at the opening ball that the camera keeps slowing down, that the speed slows down in the middle of a shot. And I remember the film is shot on Super 35 to give you more leeway with the lenses.
The lenses, and also at that time we were able to change the speed of the camera very easily.
Yeah.
There was a new device that was created, the Arri,
and
we were able to do that, so we played with it a bit.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was trying to find a different visual expression of that world and that time.
This was a world balanced so precariously that its harmony could be shattered by a whisper.
Editing was very, very difficult that way because of the rhythm, pacing of the picture, and the quiet of the film. And there was a myth that grew out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you'll never finish this film because he's always obsessed with detail.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand.
That you were holding it back because
I was so meticulous. I was trying to figure it out.
Yeah. Which played into the whole issue about the reception to the film.
Oh, the reception.
You were out of bounds, you know, and you were exploring a world that wasn't your own, and
oh,
et cetera,
boy,
et cetera.
Yes, I
get it. Within the context of people expecting...
They expected a certain kind of thing. Well, they didn't expect it from me. They didn't want it from me, really.
Well, the irony is, looking back on it, that you were accused of doing what Newland was accused of doing within the context of the story. Stepping out of your bounds?
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Right?
Yeah, you're not supposed to do it. Then the review, New York Times...
The Vincent Canby review.
Yeah, that killed it. But there were other good reviews.
Yeah.
It didn't matter, I mean.
You'd brought up Truffaut before, and one of the things that's so striking in the movie is the reading of letters. Winona Ryder is addressing the camera directly. Michelle Pfeiffer at one point looks directly to the camera, and there's a fade to red.
Well, the fades I always like to do.
Yeah.
But the fades go back to...
But those are very much like Truffaut. That's inspired
by Truffaut.
That's
much like Truffaut, but I remember when I was doing little films at... short films, and we're fading to white, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And so what if you fade to colors?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then I happen to see Black Narcissus in color for the first time. And there's a great moment towards the end where Kathleen Byron faints.
Oh, yeah.
And
the
color comes up. And then I did it again in Cape Fear.
Yeah.
A lot of that in Cape Fear. But the color that comes, that blushes.
Yes.
You know, it's like a physical sensation.
Like a surge of emotion.
Surge of emotion, mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe it's too... you know, people say, oh, it's too expressive. But I like the use of color that way. If I could paint, it would be great.
Mm-hmm.
Can't. But that's the way I would do it.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
Speaking of cinematic language, the thing with the opera glass, for instance, with the movement of the opera glass.
I tried with the opera glass, but I was always fascinated by how Stan Brakhage saw movies, or how he observed light.
Yeah.
You know, Brakhage pointed out that you don't see in a steady pan or tilt. You see, it's all fragmented. One image, many different facets.
Mm-hmm.
You're getting all these other impressions as your head moves, or as your eye moves, I should say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's fascinating. But you really, really are what is seeing, the art of seeing. You
mm-hmm.
know?
It's also when the invitations are returned to the dinner that they want to throw for Ellen, there's a rapid editing effect. You're getting all of these, you know, so sorry I can't make it, so sorry
I'm engaged that night.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. is another similar kind
it's
of...
similar, but I mean, that goes back to pre-Wells,
mm-hmm.
I would think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's something about the wave of rejection.
Yes.
That the words pile up. That's that was just the translation of that into a visual.
I just wanted to end by asking you about the kind of spirit that you established with Michael Ballhaus at this point on this movie and what your discussions were in terms of how you were going to approach this particular film visually.
Michael was so extraordinary. We knew we had it down. We understood the camera moves very, very clearly. And his lighting, mm-hmm. a kind of burnished feel to the image, the burgundies and the deep blacks. You know, we naturally refer to paintings. Mm-hmm. Actually, we recreated some of the paintings in the ball sequence. Eakin, Singer.
Yes.
And we said, this kind of light. Mm-hmm. And we found places to actually recreate what we felt was an inspiration from a particular painter.
This is the hour I like best. Don't you?
For me, that also had to do with what the light must have been like during that time.
Yes.
Come through windows.
Yeah.
Or under gaslight, you know? And so I wanted to recreate that feeling. If you're in a place where there's no electricity and you only got a candle and you appreciate the time of day changing.
Mm-hmm.
And then we tried not to do too much about their honeymoon in Paris and England.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided we'd do it through paintings.
Mm-hmm.
Another way would have been old footage. But 1870, 1876, I don't think there was really... It would be somewhat anachronistic.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's go the other way. Let's just get into detail in certain paintings and see what happens, get the impression of a trip.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The use of dissolves a lot, where it became like brush strokes,
mm-hmm.
tracking long tables with flowers and a beautifully set room for a dinner party or whatever that has a certain visceral life quality to it.
There's also that incredible recreation of the people in the windstorm in 1903.
Oh,
that's amazing.
Well, the people don't realize that there were no high buildings. So on 23rd Street,
mm-hmm.
That's where all the wind from both rivers would hit. And then you had to hang on to your hat. And it was
literally
walking against the wind. Yeah.
But it's interesting because the impression of color, light, smudges of light and going through layers of things, that's what Saul and Elaine Bass did in their...
Well, that was the opening titles. They just simply made a summation of the movie.
Yeah.
Right there.
Yeah.
As it was so beautiful. Mm. Really, in Elmer Bernstein's music.
Mm-hmm.
Elmer, we listened to Brahms a bit.
Yeah.
Did some of that, but he did his own way,
mm-hmm.
Permeating the entire picture, like inhabiting the film, mm-hmm. you know?
Yes.
Yeah. It's a very different thing with Elmer. Extraordinary in what he did. We tried to pull it together. Even the opening titles are changing the logo, the mm-hmm. color of the logo.
Mm-hmm.
As I say, we were experimenting.
Mm-hmm. I think the experiment turned out pretty well.
Okay. Thank you.